Welcome to Talent Magnet, brought to you by Pacific Mountain Workforce Development Council, the podcast where we help businesses become talent magnets by focusing on recruitment, training, and retention best practices. And now here's your host, Michelle Wynn.
As we enter a new year with COVID-19 reopening guidance for businesses and workers in Washington, we want to bring you the latest information from Washington's Department of Labor and Industries. Today, I have a co-host with me, Emily Sixta, Project Coordinator for Customer Solutions from the Thurston County Chamber. Emily is also our COVID Response Coordinator at the Chamber. Welcome, Emily.
Hi, thank you, Michelle.
Yeah, it's great to have you here with me today. We have a special guest here today. Her name is Erica Minton, and she is the Industrial Hygiene Consultant with L&I. Labor and Industries is responsible for overseeing health and safety rules in Washington state workplaces. Erica was an L&I compliance officer for about 2 years prior to her current position. She has previous work experience in environmental health and safety at the university level, and also a BS and a background in microbiology, which allowed her to do some clinical research early in her career. Welcome, Erica.
Thanks for having me.
Erica, why don't you start by telling us a little bit about what drew you to industrial hygiene and the work that you do at L&I?
So it's kind of a long story, but the short version is I started out kind of as a lab worker early in my career, and I encountered kind of a serious lack of safety communication. So I'd get assignments to work with these chemicals, these reagents. I'd have no idea what I was working with, and it turns out that they're carcinogens or, you know, acutely toxic, and my supervisors wouldn't tell me about them. And it wasn't because they were being like malicious or anything. It was just, they didn't think about it. They just needed the job done. And so after the fact, I realized that, hey, I wasn't wearing the right personal protective equipment. I didn't have the information I needed to do my job safely. So I really kind of got interested in educating other people to kind of take ownership of what they're working with and understand the hazards that they're working with.
So Erica, one of my functions at the Thurston Chamber is heading our pandemic response team for our staff, as well as providing resources and direction to businesses as it's released. There's a lot of information out there. What are some key takeaways that all Washington state businesses should know in relation to COVID-19 requirements?
So there's a, like you said, there's a lot of information out there. The biggest thing is that things are constantly in flux because it's an evolving pandemic and things are changing as we go. Some of the initial things that we did early on in the pandemic have not changed. So keep your social distance, wash your face, or wash your hands. Don't touch your face. Make sure you're wearing a mask when you're going out in public. And then just kind of be aware of the potential risks that you're doing in your day-to-day activities that might put you at risk for COVID exposure.
Absolutely. And so in regard to masks in the workplace, specifically in areas where employees are in cubicles or separated by dividers, what does L&I recommend when it comes to wearing masks while at your desk?
So it gets a little complicated. It depends on what your office layout actually is. If you have an office where you can close the door, like the one behind me, as you can see, I'm not wearing a mask. I'm in the office because I can close the door. I'm not around other people, and that's fine. If you're in a cubicle with tall walls and you don't sit adjacent to somebody else, then you're fine to take off the mask because you're not in the same breathing zone and you're more than 6 feet away. If you're sitting right next to somebody at a cubicle, you'd still need to keep your mask on. If you have to get up to, say, go print something, you want to put that mask back on because you might have some interaction with people.
You know, I'm lucky right now. I get to work from home, but I have quite a variety of masks available to me when I go out. I have, you know, ones that are easier to wear that are a little bit softer. I have some of like the surgical masks. I recently just bought one that's more like a cup, kind of like the N95, but not exactly. Are there specific types of masks that are required for employees to wear?
So it really depends on your risk level and what type of activity you're doing. It might change throughout the day. If you're working in a low risk scenario, we have this document called which mask for which task. It looks like this. It goes through different scenarios, but typically if you're in a low risk situation, you can just use a cloth face covering. You don't have a lot of potential to interact with people. You can maintain your social distance. There's not a serious risk of COVID unless you're, you know, out in the population. If you're more of a medium risk, say you're like a grocery care or grocery store worker, you'd want to wear something that's a little bit more engineered, like a surgical mask or one that you can throw away. Once you get into those higher risk categories, say dental or places where you're going to have more human interaction, be breaking that social distance, you need to consider something that's more like an N95 or a KN95 that has a face shield if you can't get those N95s. And then an extremely high risk situation, you'd have to have an N95 or better and make sure that you have all of the respiratory protection requirements. You know, there's fit testing, there's medical evaluations, making sure you're actually protected, because in that scenario, you'd be expected to have some contact with COVID patients. So it really just depends, and you have to assess what you're doing throughout the day. But typically the lowest level is going to be that cloth face covering. And then for kind of medium interaction, you want at least like a surgical mask.
That's great information. And, you know, just to follow up on the surgical masks, you said throw them away. I would imagine not everybody is throwing them away. Like, how many uses are they supposed to get out of a surgical mask?
Well, really, it's not so much uses. It's, is it still clean? Does it still have integrity to the elastic? You know, if it's obviously dirty, you shouldn't be putting that back on your face. You know, the idea is to not rebreathe your own germs or other people's germs when you're out and about. So if you went to somewhere that was crowded and you feel like there was an exposure, you should get rid of it. You really should be disposing them each time. Or if you have that cloth face covering, you should be rewashing them frequently enough, or just change them out, stagger them out so that you can have time for it to, you know, any potential exposure to dissipate before you put it back on your face.
That is great advice. Thank you. Well, since things seem to be in constant flux, you know, we even just got new reopening guidance a couple of weeks ago from Governor Inslee. Where do businesses go to get the most current information and updates on COVID specific requirements?
So that's a good question. The governor's website is probably the first place to get information about his new program, the roadmap to recovery for safe and healthy Washington, is on governor.wa.gov. He also does frequent news updates, so you can subscribe to get those as well. The other place where businesses can go is coronavirus.wa.gov. That has specific information for specific types of industries. It also has for public or education as well. There's also our website, Labor and Industries, under Safety and Health. You can search for coronavirus. There's a plethora of information there.
So as vaccinations are distributed, what is the protocol for employees that have been vaccinated? Do they need to continue to adhere to mask, temperature check, social distancing protocols that are set in place, or what does that look like for them?
So really not a lot's going to change in the short term, because we don't really know how long people are going to be protected by the vaccine. We don't know if it's going to protect against variants. And then just logistically, how are businesses really going to track who's got what vaccine, and, you know, if they still need to make sure that other people are protected? It's kind of visually going to be difficult to understand who's actually had the vaccine. And since it's an experimental vaccine, no one's going to be forced to take it. So we just really have to keep in mind that in the short term, nothing really is going to change until like CDC and Department of Health decide that we can take a next step. So just be patient with the vaccine rollout, because it's going to take some time.
Yeah, it's hard to be patient anymore, isn't it? As we've already hit like the 1 year mark, especially here in Washington, where we had the first case over a year ago. You know, in your experience, Erica, working with businesses and in the consultations program, what areas of COVID compliance have businesses most struggled with, or have been really falling short in maintaining compliance?
I think it's exactly what you just hit on, is everyone's getting tired of the new regulations, or, you know, I call it COVID fatigue. I know I'm kind of tired of talking about it and hearing about it, because it's just a constant topic of conversation in the news. And so when things change, sometimes It's easy to just kind of brush it aside and say, oh yeah, it's a new change, we're gonna get around to it, but just not staying as diligent as businesses could potentially, or say even employees don't wanna keep wearing the masks, and it's really hard to make somebody, you know, follow those rules. So it's just, I think overall complacency and getting kind of lax in the COVID precautions. And, you know, it was not any business's fault that this came about. So we understand, but at the same time, you have to stay diligent and maintain your COVID protocols.
And Erica, in maintaining COVID protocols, you've mentioned that you're part of the consultation team with DOSH. Is there a catch to using the consultation services?
Not at all. It's absolutely free. We have to be invited in by businesses. We can come on site and do a safety and health walkthrough, or we can review your programs remotely, or we can just answer questions. We're here to help educate what the current safety and health rules are on COVID or any other topic. You know, that's one thing that we want to make sure the other safety and health protocols that you have, not just COVID, are still in effect so that you have a safe and healthy workforce.
That's really good to know. I think there's, you know, a lot of hesitancy to invite L&I in, but if it's free and they give you the guidance that you need on both the COVID regulations as well as other safety and health issues, it's better, you know, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, as they say. And I think it's really important for people to seriously consider that. Before we go, is there any other advice, Erica, that you would like to provide with businesses on staying compliant with COVID regulations?
I just reiterate, you know, maintain checking those websites that we mentioned, maintain, you know, social distance, cleaning your facilities, making sure everyone's wearing their masks, and then contact consultation if you have any questions, if you're not sure about something, or if you'd like to know a little bit more about this new roadmap to recovery or any changes that have come out, just give us a call or contact us online. We have all sorts of resources for you.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. We're going to make sure that we put all of the resources listed in the show notes beneath the information on the podcast, as well as thurstonchamber.com's website, where Emily has created a toolkit for businesses as well. So thank you both for joining me. I'm really excited to get this information out to the public. And hopefully remind them, you know, the most important aspects that you discussed today. Thank you.
Thank you.
You've been listening to Talent Magnet, brought to you by Pacific Mountain Workforce Development Council in partnership with the Thurston County Chamber. If you've enjoyed the episode, please subscribe to the podcast and also leave us a rating and review. Thank you so much for listening, and we'll be back soon with a new episode.